It is time for our national security foreign policy update. James, welcome back in studio. Big decision from the president with regards to our forces in Europe. We'll talk about that momentarily. But I know that you, your team, the great people at the Heritage Foundation, looking over the horizon, preparing for what happens next. We have allegedly some preliminary agreements between the federal government and certain municipalities. What happens next in places like Portland and Seattle? And what is the key to bringing some sanity and security back to these cities?
Right. So we ought to talk about where we are, which is the one thing I've really tried to make here is this looks like organized criminal activity. Right. These are not protests. As a military, a guy that's worked in the military years, you understand tactics. What you're seeing on the ground are tactics.
Yeah.
Tactics aren't a bunch of people that just kind of make it. It's not like a pickup basketball game. Somebody's got to organize, train, equip, and supply you. That's an organization. Organized criminal activity isn't itself a crime. It's a conspiracy. And here's why that they can get away with this is because they need the streets and the parks in the surrounding area to stage these assaults on the building. And because the city and state have not policed the city streets, and the federal government really has no jurisdiction to police those streets, that's why these attacks can go on, and they've been going on for weeks and weeks. So the notion that somehow the federal government caused the violence, lie. That they're an occupying force, lie. The only place that they reinforced were in Portland, because the Federal Protective Service, which is part of the Department of Homeland Security, they only had like a dozen officials for all the federal property in Portland. So when they got assaulted, they said, we need additional help. So the Homeland Security Department sent additional people to Portland. So it was not an occupation in any way, shape, or form. And the only thing doing there, the only people they arrest, the only time they come out of the building is to protect federal property.
Or personnel.
Like, exactly. These are riots that come out like between midnight and 5 a.m. They're designed actually to pull the federal personnel out so they can injure them. Right.
Right.
So what has to happen is the federal, state, and local have to work together.
Let's stop on the first thing you said. So I did a long British radio interview for The Times, and I had to explain from them from scratch. And sometimes we have to remind our own listeners, our own citizens, you know, there is no federal police force. When you say right. public safety in America, right. a Brit or a Frenchman might say, well, why doesn't the federal police of America deal with it?
Right.
Because we don't have a federal police right. force. We have what? We have 17,000 law enforcement agencies, from sheriffs to
right.
you name it.
And what the federal government has is about 40 different law enforcement agencies for different, like,
with specific mandates.
Right, like the Coast Guard. The Coast yes. Guard actually is a law enforcement agency.
Correct.
They arrest you at sea. If you add all of them up together, there are a little more, every single federal officer, there are a little more than the New York City Police Department.
Right, which is 40,000.
Right.
And as a vice, 600,000 others
right.
who aren't feds.
So even if this notion that somehow the president is planning to occupy our cities.
To invade Seattle. Right.
Yeah, give me a break.
So what we're talking about is all of these people working together.
Right.
That's when we have safety.
Right. So, you know, I think we mentioned this last time. You know, I was watching a documentary about Whitey Bulger, who ran rampant crazy in Boston for years. Why did he do that? Well, in part because federal, state, and local guys weren't working together. And those bad guys operated within the seams. Before we were, during the break, we were talking about, people forget, remember when New York City really was the center of the seventh circle of hell in the 70s and 80s? That happened to actually coincide with the strongest period of organized crime in New York City, when the mafia was at its peak.
Why would that happen at the same time?
Because in this case, the federal government wasn't there, right? And when the federal government came in and started working with the city, because the mafia, come on, you remember the famous scene from The Godfather, Don, we want the politicians and the judges that you have in your pocket, right? Because the mafia had so penetrated local and state law enforcement that they were powerless to deal with the mafia. And the federal government came in, everybody pulled together. We broke the back of the mob in the 1980s.
Right.
That's what's responsible for the Renaissance in New York from the 1990s.
Absolutely. There is a reason these things occur. Let's talk about the very first thing you said, that this is organized violence. This isn't spontaneous. This isn't amorphous. When you have accelerants being stockpiled, when you have industrial-grade fireworks, when you have ball bearings being fired at federal offices, when you have lasers. This isn't because I'm a peaceful protester and then suddenly I pick up a laser to blind somebody.
And they were smart enough to go where there was a permissive environment.
Yes.
Where there were not, it's not the police, where there were city and state officials that were not willing to enforce the law that allowed these guys to operate.
Sorry. Now, all of this stuff is indisputable. We have the evidence that this is occurring. But there's a fascinating phenomena that you can't point your finger at a structure or a leadership. A few years ago, somebody came up in our field of you know, national security and counterterrorism with the concept of leaderless jihad. Do you remember this?
Yeah, and that's not what's going on
here. No. But this idea that you have violence in multiple cities, but there's no, you know, France Fanon, there's no one person who's identified with it. Isn't this a fascinating aspect of the violence? That on the one hand, it's tactically sound, but at a strategic level, it's kind of like smoke.
Yeah, I'm not sure that's true, though.
Well, tell us.
No, I think that one of the things that we have to investigate here, and I don't know, I'm just saying, if you look at the evidence before you, this is an indication of an organized crime operation.
Activity.
That transcends local groups, that has to have enormous amounts of funding. So this could be a national
But at the moment, we don't have that name or that structure, that center of gravity.
But you have to look at groups like Black Lives Matter and Antifa, who have a national presence, who've been present in all these cities and all these riots, and who have been conducting organizational activities. Now, whether you can directly say they are doing organized crime, that's something that has to be proved. But you look where there's smoke. So I think that's where I would start.
Can you have what you're talking about, which is the effective cooperation between different jurisdictions, different levels of agency from local to federal? Can that even happen, James Carafano, if the political environment remains permissive to the rioters?
Well, I mean, look, you've even seen in Portland and in Portland and Seattle, some kind of back off of this. So, for example, the governor of Oregon said, okay, look, I want the federal agents out. And here's what and she called them an occupying force, a lie. She said they were responsible for the violence, a lie. And here's what they agreed to. They said, you know what? We will draw down because the only reason why they're there is to protect the courthouse. When the danger to the courthouse is reduced, we will reduce our presence. And if the city polices the streets around the courthouse so the attackers can't organize, there won't be a need for our guys. That's what they agreed to. And the governor agreed to that, I think in part because they are worried about this thing getting out of control, for the same reason that in the end Seattle went back and they disorganized the autonomous zone, although they just said they're going to abolish their police. Can you just
expand on that last point?
No, okay, let me just finish, because the one thought is, I actually think, and we'll see, by standing strong in Portland, what the president of the United States may have done is nipped this in the bud, and it's a tactic that potentially, because we've countered it in Portland, won't expand to other cities, but that means that these guys will go off and try and do something else.
Even if Seattle disbands its police force?
Well, here's the problem with that. You know, they say they're going to disband their police force and replace it with some public
social
safety,
worker,
blah, blah, blah.
Whatever.
Look, you know, I think back to my example of New York in the 1970s. If you're telling me that you are disbanding your police force, why don't you just put it on an advertisement and said, if you are an organized criminal organization, if you are the mafia or a drug cartel or a transnational gang, or you're a serial killer or any kind of serial criminal, come to Seattle.
Right.
Here is a rich, defenseless population for you to come after. I think Seattle, if they actually follow through on this, they're going to have all kinds of trouble, because if this, whatever this public safety thing, if it's going to deal with these organized crime things, you know what? It's going to look just like a police department.
If you're a bad guy, it's called red teaming in the U.S. Army. You try and think like the bad guy. If you're a bad guy, what are you going to react when you hear that a city is disbanding his police force? You know the answer to that question. We're talking to the Vice President for National Security Foreign Policy at the Heritage Foundation. Join them today, heritage.org, and follow this man as he prevents World War III, one tweet at a time, JJ Carafano on Twitter. I'm Sebastian Gorka. This is America First.